Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa wa salamun ala ibadihi alladhina istafa la siyama al-mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallama tasliman kathira. All praise due to Allah alone. We praise him and we seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is the truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Dear viewers everywhere, welcome to a new edition of Ask Huda. In the beginning of this edition, I would like to extend our condolence to the families of the victims who have suffered this heinous attack in Alexandria, Egypt, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on us and protect us all against all different calamities and the plots of those who are plotting against our safety and security. And also would like to express the condemnation of Huda TV and its scholars to any heinous act like that which is not approved by any religion whatsoever. Those who are behind this barbaric attack do not belong to a religion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, من أجل ذلك كتبنا على بني إسرائيل أنه من قتل نفسا بغير نفس أو فساد في الأرض فكأنما قتل الناس جميعا ومن أحياها فكأنما أحيا الناس جميعا. Killing a single person without a just cause or in order to spread mischief and corruption on earth is similar to killing the entire humanity at large. This is how valuable is the human soul in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, especially for those who are considered Ahlul Zimma or Mu'ahadeen, minorities of the people of the book who are living amongst Muslims who have a treaty of protection, which the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam guaranteed and stood surety for. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect all Muslim countries and those who are living in the Muslim countries against any evil. Ameen. The second, let me remind you with our phone numbers for those who will be interested in calling us live and presenting their questions. Area code 002-0238-555-248 or 249. A couple of pending questions I have since last episode. One which is from Sister Aisha from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. She asked about some lotions contain alcohol. Can you pray after applying them? That's a good question. Basically, I would not say, can you pray after applying them? I would ask whether it is permissible or not, whether it is pure or impure. Alcohol which is contained in topical applicants or applications, lotions, perfumes, or makeup, is very insignificant and is not considered to be intoxicant. The ruling is, if alcohol which is toxicant, which is considered as khamr, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Kullu muskirin haram, kullu muskirin khamr, wa kullu khamrin haram. If any alcohol or any intoxicant is causing a person to be intoxicated, then it is haram whether it is a little or a lot. But whenever the amount is very insignificant, and it is not the same kind of alcohol which is used as intoxicant, and it is not used internally, rather it is in some medications, particularly in this question, topical applications, lotions, and substances like that, then it is permissible and it is not impure. I would also like to mention that there is a difference of opinions with regards to the purity or the impurity of alcohol itself as intoxicant, the khamr. While the vast majority of the scholars considered it najis due to the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ والميسر والأنصاب والأزلام رجس من عمل الشيطان فاجتنبوه لعلكم تفلحون. They relied on this verse as that khamr or intoxicants are impure, najis, physical impurity, that if you touch it, you have to wash it off, you have to wash your body off. And that is not the right view or the more right view. The more right view that the impurity here is moral, simply because while poison is haram, but it is not impure. So the fiqh rule is that kullu najis haram. Everything that is judged by the sharia as impure, then it is prohibited to be consumed. Urine or any the disease of dead animals, these are impurities. So one cannot keep them with him while praying, cannot possess any of them, or cannot have any of the traces against his body or clothes while praying, because that is impure. But the opposite is not true. Not every haram is najis. Wallahu a'lam. So, bottom line, it is permissible to use such topical applications, even though they contain alcohol, because it is a very insignificant amount. The first phone call today, assalamu alaikum. Sister Samia from United Arab Emirates, assalamu alaikum.
I have three questions.
Go ahead.
The first one is, when I'm usually praying, my daughter comes in front of me. She's quite young. She's 1.5 years old.
How old is she?
She's 1.5 years old.
Okay.
So she sometimes plays in front of me, or she comes in front of me when I'm praying. Is my prayer valid or not?
Okay.
And the second one is, now I have quite a few fasts that I have to do, which are fard fasting that I have missed during Ramadan, and also some of them are fasts which I have promised, which I'm trying to make up.
You mean nazr?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's right. So now I want to know, sometimes I'm up late, like maybe 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock in the morning. Can I eat suhoor then and go to sleep, or do I have to wake up for suhoor separately for these fasts?
Okay.
Okay. The third question is, now someone I know, he has bought a property and he has rented it out. He has a family and they are not sure what they're going to do with the property. They live in another flat, but with the house, they've rented it. They don't know whether they're going to live in it in the future or not.
Okay.
So I want to know how does zakat be applicable on this house? Do they calculate it on the rent that is coming from the tenants of that house that they bought, or is it on the property of the on the value of the whole house that they have to pay the zakat?
Okay.
But they're not sure whether they're going to live in it in the future. They might stay in it. They might not.
I got it. Thank you, sister.
Okay, thank you.
You're most welcome. Bashir from Egypt. Assalamu alaikum, Bashir.
Wa alaikum salam.
How are you?
Fine. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
We've come here in Egypt, but do we still continue doing qasr for like 4 months?
I'm sorry, I didn't get your question. You said you're staying in Egypt and you're doing qasr?
No, I came for studies.
Okay.
So I'll be here for like 6 months. I don't know, do I continue doing qasr?
For 6 months?
Yeah.
Okay, I got your question.
Then, secondly, if the time for prayer comes and goes while you're still on your flight, how will you conduct the prayer?
Okay.
Thirdly, I want to know the ruling of a person joining a masbuk to reestablish jamiyah.
Okay, I got it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bashir. Jazakumullah khairan. Umm Ruqayya from Nigeria had a very interesting question. She said that while she was going to perform Umrah, her plan initially was to go to Al-Madinah first. Then from there, she would assume an intention of Ihram from the proper miqat of al-Madina, which is Dhul Hulaifa or Abi Yar Ali, as it is known today, then come to perform Umrah. But the plan has changed. When she landed to Jeddah Airport, she did not find a flight. And she ended up making an intention of Umrah from Jeddah, which is not her miqat. Does she owe any penalty? First of all, if any person was going from any destination to Al-Madinah first, then decided to come from Al-Madinah to perform Umrah, so Al-Miqat will be more befitting to do the Ihram from Dhul Hulaifa. If any person visited Jeddah for business, for trade, for whatever reason, and he had no intention of performing Umrah, then all of a sudden they decided to initiate an intention of performing Umrah, then they may assume the intention of performing Umrah or Hajj from Jeddah. They don't have to return back to their miqat, because they become like resident temporarily in Jeddah. The case here is neither this nor that. She was planning to go to Al-Madinah. So I'd say that even if you did not find a flight, you should have taken any means of transportation, go by bus or a private cab or whatever to Al-Madinah. But the general ruling, if any person was in Jeddah, not for the intention of performing Umrah, he had another destination or whatever, he was stranded there, there's no flights, there's a flood like nowadays, could not go to Al-Madinah, then in this case, your Umrah and Ihram is valid, and you don't have to offer any penalty because you did not deliberately skip the miqat and arrive to Jeddah, whether knowingly or unknowingly. As far as you try to catch up and you say the intention while you are in the plane, it doesn't make any difference because you already passed your miqat. So if you did not intend initially to come to Jeddah and from there to perform Umrah, it was not your plan, but out of your control that you ended up in Jeddah, then in this case, inshallah, you do not owe any fidya. It was not your intention. But you should have taken any other means of transportation to go to Al-Madinah, make your visit, then assume the intention of Ihram from Abi Yar Ali. Next phone call, Sister Halima from Egypt. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum
assalam. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. I love the entire people, the entire staff of Huda, for the sake of Allah.
Jazakumullahu khairan. Thank you so much.
Please, I would like to know, I learned that there is two calls for the Fajr prayer. The first one and the second one. Please, I would like to know, because some people say the first one you can pray Rak'at al-Fajr and Subh prayer. Is it at the same time or after the second?
Okay.
And my second question is about also the fasting. If you are going to do a voluntary fasting, when do you stop eating? I mean, in the night when you are going to do
okay.
the fasting. Thank you very much. Very healthy.
Thank you, Sister Halima. Brother Abdul Rahman had two interesting questions. He said, nowadays we see a number of girls and women wearing jeans. I'd like to ask whether is it allowed in Islam or not. It is not allowed in Islam to show the awrah or to cover the awrah but with revealing clothes. So, the Prophet ﷺ considered women who may be dressed up entirely but either wearing see-through or wearing tight revealing clothes as naked. He said, kasiyatun ariyat. You can call them kasiyat, dressed up in a sense. But in fact, they're not. They're ariyat. They're showing their awrah. So what we see nowadays in some of the contemporary dua say that is better than nothing that is absolutely false. It is either to respond entirely to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or you do not consider this a hijab. Because if a woman is not wearing hijab, she knows that she is not wearing hijab, we keep giving her da'wah, we keep asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide her, and she senses that she's not complying with the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when somebody feels like I'm better than others, or at least somebody said it is okay, or I'm covering my hair, but how good is it to cover the hair while the entire body is exposed. And the awra of a woman, the bottom and the front, and these are all tempting areas that is not permissible. And I hope and I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would guide our sisters, our mothers, and our daughters to the truth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ذَلِكَ أَدْنَا أَن يُعْرَفْنَا فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ. When you see a girl who's wearing very tight jeans, very tight blouse, exposing the details of the body, then is wearing a scarf or a piece of clothes, that doesn't make any sense. That is not called hijab under any circumstances. The second question of his was, these days a lot of shows related to astrology and numerology, which predict the future. So he wants to know whether it is okay to call those shows and predict his future or not, or the Islamic ruling on that. In the last verse of Surah Luqman, that is verse number 34, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ. So we counted five particular knowledges that no one possesses other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not even an angel nor a prophet. The knowledge of the time of the hour, the day of judgment. مَا الْمَسْؤُولُ عَنْهَا بِأَعْلَمَ مِنَ السَّائِلِ. In that answer, the Prophet ﷺ answered Jibreel, neither you nor me know anything about its time. وَيُنَزِّلُ الْغَيْثِ, and he sends down the rain. وَيَعْلَمُ مَا فِي الْأَرْحَامِ, and he knows what's in the wombs, whether it will live or not, male or a female, even while it's just a zygote. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ مَاذَا تَكْسِبُ غَدًا, and no soul knows what will it earn tomorrow, earn or lose. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ, and no one knows where he or she, or when he or she will die. بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ, where? Because إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ, all-knowing and well-acquainted. So if any person claims that he knows the future, will say, so how come that you're living in a miserable life? If you truly know the future, if you're a soothsayer or a fortune teller or a palmist or whatever, you could be a millionaire, know exactly which lotto would be the winner. And in a stock market, you can predict which stock is going up and which stock is going down, if you really know the truth. Or you can protect yourself against calamities, but this is all false. Some people take it as, I'm just taking it for fun, wasting my time, or at least because they give you the first 3 minutes for free. You can call them for free. The Prophet ﷺ said in the Sahih Hadith, whosoever goes to or visits with a'raf, a fortune teller or a soothsayer, then ask him and he believes in him, فَقَدِ كَفَرَ بِمَا أُنزِلَ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ, has disbelieved in what was revealed upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you gotta be very careful with that. Another phone call. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Hey, wa assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Umm Ibrahim from Saudi, Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Assalamu alaikum.
Shaykh, I have three questions to ask. First question is that I am reading Surah Baqarah once in 3 days. But I don't get time to read in one day whole Surah Baqarah. So what I am doing, I divide it in three parts and try to complete in 3 days, one third like this. Is this permissible or not?
Okay.
And second thing I want to ask, that I am working, so I don't get time to read Quran in the house. So when I am free on my job, I work in hospital, I'm a doctor, there I am reading this Surah Baqarah. So this will have the effect as if I am reading in my house.
Okay.
Okay. The second question I want to ask, that usually I am seeing snakes in my dream very frequent. What should I do? Yani, does this have any meaning or what?
What about, what you see in a dream?
Snake.
Snakes.
Yeah.
Okay.
So does this have any meaning, or it is just from Shaitan, this dream?
Okay.
Third question is that if there is a spot of blood on the clothes, this will be considered as najas for praying, or it should be a large amount, or just even a spot has to be cleaned for prayer?
Okay.
Okay. These three questions, Sheikh.
Okay. Jazakumullah khairan, Dr. Ibrahim. Thank you so much. Sister Fatima from Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, Shaykh. Good evening.
Good evening to you.
Please, my question is about dinner type. If proposed fiancé is the same dinner type as you, maybe AS, and there's a possibility of her.
You're breaking off. Fatima, you're breaking off. I cannot hear you clearly.
Hello?
Yeah, can you start over, please?
Okay, it's about genotype. If your proposed fiancé has the same genotype as you, AS, is the probability of having a sister, is it permissible for us to marry or to get somebody else?
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Fatima, from Nigeria. Sister Samira from United Arab Emirates, she called in today and she said that her youngster or the baby who is a year and a half old crosses before her while she is praying. We said before that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that whenever you pray, you should pray towards a sutra or a barrier. And the purpose of the sutra is to make you gain a maximum concentration and khushu' in the salah. So that if somebody is trying to cross before you, it would not disturb you. And if any person is trying to cross in between you and the sutra, you should repel him off, you should resist him. If they're adults, but when once you have a baby, I would advise you to put him in a stroller or fasten him in a seat or something until you pray. The prayer would not take more than 10 minutes, 15 minutes at maximum. Me and my spouse experience the same thing. So when we keep the child is playing around us, of course he has to keep crossing before me, or before my wife, or before those who are praying. I know beforehand that he is going to do that. So why would I leave this to happen? If somebody has to use the bathroom, if somebody has to do something that is important, or cooking that, you do not leave the child at the loose. So it is best to fasten him in their strollers until you offer your prayer in order to gain khushu' in the salah. Is it permissible if they're crying to carry the baby while crying and go up and down with him or her? Yes, that is permissible. Another phone call. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Muhammad from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. How are you?
Great. Alhamdulillah. And thank you for asking.
Jazakallah khair, ya Sheikh. I really love this program very much. I'm an Indian. I would like this light to be spreading in my country, India, throughout.
Ameen.
Inshallah. I have a question on interest. I have an interest with me, and I am trying to get rid of. But I am faced with a situation. I have a cousin. She is going to get married. There is an evil practice in India that the dowry, you know, the boys, they demand dowry there. So can I use this dowry for giving her in dowry? Can I use this interest?
Okay. Okay, I'll answer you, inshallah.
It's an evil practice, but I want to choose the lesser evil.
Okay. Thank you, Muhammad. Jazakallahu khairan. Okay. She also inquired about that she stays up sometimes until 2 or 3 a.m. That's understood. If you have a 1.5-year-old child, that's very normal. So she says that whenever she intends to fast, whether an obligatory fasting that she missed, she wants to make up, or nadr, or even voluntary fasting, can she take her suhoor or the meal before fajr at 2 or 3 a.m.? Yes, of course. The purpose of the suhoor, as the Prophet ﷺ commanded, تَسَحَّرُوا فَإِنَّ فِي السُّحُورِ بَرَكَةً. There is a blessing in the suhoor. So by taking a date or some yogurt, or drinking water with the intention of, or a glass of milk, this is suhoor, that is sufficient. It doesn't have to be a full meal. The purpose of that, in order to support you throughout your fasting day, provide you with the needed energy and supplement. So if this is the case, and you can do it even before Fajr, an hour or two before Fajr, that is permissible, inshallah, Azza Jal, and you will be rewarded for taking the suhoor meal. Her third question was pertaining a property that they possess or somebody possessed, but they are not planning yet what they're going to do with it. Invest in it, resell it, build a house and live on it. There is no zakah on such property as long as you are undecided. Only when you decide this is for business or you bought it with the intention of investment to resell it and make a profit on it, that's a different category which will be zakatable. A property which you have and you have not decided yet, most likely you might build a house on it, or. So this is a property that does not owe zakah. Another phone call, assalamu alaikum. Sister Halima from Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Halima.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Please, I want to know if it is permissible to eat food brought by Christians on Christmas Day.
Okay, great.
Yes, that's my only question.
Okay.
Thank you, Shaykh.
You're most welcome. Thank you. Another phone call from Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam, ya Sheikh.
Brother Billu, how are you?
Alhamdulillah, I'm fine. How are you, sir?
Great, alhamdulillah. What's your question, brother?
My question is, I want to ask you whether is it permissible for a Muslim brother to condemn somebody who's a Christian during Christmas?
Okay. Thank you. Bashir from Egypt had three questions. He said that he came to study in Egypt and is planning to stay for 6 months. Is he allowed to shorten the prayer throughout his stay? No. The opinion of Al-Jumhur, the vast majority of the jurists, that if you intend to stay beyond 4 days, then you must pray on full. You pray regular, every prayer on its fixed time, and you pray it in jama'ah with the relating nawafil, and you pray it full. The 4 rak'ahs will be offered as 4. You do not get to shorten the prayer. Especially, you have already decided and planned that you're staying for 6 months, so you know. But if somebody came and he doesn't know how long he's staying, he says, I might leave tomorrow, or next week, or whatever. So there is another opinion which says, as long as he has not decided, even if he lasts more than 6 months, because he did not determine when is he leaving. He is on a standby. But you've already decided, you're staying for 6 months, so you should pray on full. He is also asking about praying while flying. How can he pray the prayer time before its time is out? And we did explain that repeatedly before, and there is a whole chapter which is prayer while traveling, particularly while you're airborne. There is a concession that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted the travelers to shorten the prayer. فَلَيْسَ عَلَيْكُمْ جُنَاحٌ أَن تَقْصُرُوا مِنَ الصَّلَاةِ إِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَن يَفْتِنَكُمُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. There is no blame on you to shorten your prayer. Obviously, that concession was given at the time of when Muslims were afraid if they traveled that they might be attacked by the disbelievers. And that was extended afterward since Umar ibn Khattab, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu ardah, asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, nowadays we are in a state of security. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, رُخْصَةٌ, this is a concession that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted you and a gift, you should accept it. So, if you are flying, you're allowed to join two prayers at the time of either one, either the earlier or the later. And these two prayers are Dhuhr and Asr together in one bundle, Maghrib and Isha together. So you do not join Maghrib and Asr, nor do you join Fajr with any prayer. It's either Dhuhr and Asr at the time of either one, or Maghrib and Isha at the time of either one of them. If you're flying and you know that it's already Dhuhr time, and you might reach your final destination or your transit before sunset, then it is permissible for you to postpone the prayer until you reach your final destination where you can pray with comfort, standing and facing the Qibla on a clean spot, pray Asr, Dhuhr and Asr, as long as it is before sunset. But if you assume that my flight will take 12 hours or more than 6 hours, so I would not get a chance to pray before the time of the third prayer. In this condition, You can pray, if it is possible, standing and facing the Qibla. If it is not possible, then in your seat and as much as you can, and you get to shorten the prayer. Dhuhr and Asr, 2 rak'ahs each, and Isha, 2 rak'ah, and Maghrib will be as is. Wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam. Another phone call. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Zubair from Libya.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam, Zubair. How are you?
Fine, Sheikh. How are you?
Good, alhamdulillah. Where are you from originally?
I have two questions to ask you.
Okay, and I have one question to ask you. Where are you from?
Libya.
Oh, originally from Libya?
Yeah.
Okay. What are your questions?
Is it permissible to work as a boxer or not?
As a boxer?
Wrestling. Yes.
Is it permissible to work as a boxer?
As a boxer or a wrestler. And my second question is, maybe you want to fast and Monday, and you wake up in the sober, you take the photo. Can you sleep before you wake up to make, maybe they haven't made azan?
Okay.
Can you sleep after wake, you hear azan, you wake up and pray.
Okay. Jazakumullahu khairan, Zubayr. And brothers and sisters, we'll take a short break and return back pretty soon, so stay tuned.
Philosophy of Islamic Law, a program for restoring belief and trust within Muslims' mind and heart, and for re-establishing a true concept about Islamic rules for others.
Amazing stories. In this program, we get to know about people of the past whose stories were mentioned in the Islamic tradition and related by the Prophet, peace be upon him.
That verily us, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we tell you about the best of the stories. We tell you about the best of the stories. When we narrate a story, when we read a story, when we try to benefit from a story, what we are trying to do in reality is to go back through the steps, through the different parts and sections of this story until the story is actually completed and that we can take the actual benefit directly from the story.
Sheikh Lutfi will narrate these stories in his program Amazing Stories.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered one of the lands to come closer, the destination. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered one whole city to come closer, to move closer to this dead person.
Proactive. Dr. Haitham Al-Haddad teaches us how to take a conscious control over our life, set our goals, and work to achieve them in Islam. Take firm steps towards your future. Be positive and be proactive.
Every single Muslim needs to have in order to be an effective person.
So proactivity in Islam, how to serve our religion and how to serve our life and our guides through all of this.
The proactive person is always motivated. The proactive person always have high ambition. The proactive person, he will not lose his time. He will not waste his time. The proactive person is a generous person.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Bashir had another question pertaining ahkam al-masbuq, the ruling on a person who attends a prayer after the imam have already elapsed some of its contents, first rak'ah or second rak'ah or whatever. First of all, if you join the imam or the jama'ah and the imam is in a state of ruku' or bowing down, if you manage to learn the imam with comfort and you say the takbiratul ihram, Allahu Akbar, then you go for ruku' while the imam is still ruku' and you manage to say subhana rabbiyal azim at least once before the imam rises up, that counts for you as a rak'ah with the congregation. And you'll be exempt in this condition from reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. This is one of the conditions where the follower is exempt from reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. And the rak'ah counts as one rak'ah for him. We have the hadith in which some of the companions hurried in order to join the prayer with the Prophet ﷺ. And after he finished the prayer, he said, سَمِعَ جَلَبَةَ رِجَال, as it is narrated by Imam al-Bukhari, when he heard the noise, he said, what was that? They said, we're trying to join the prayer. And the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا أَتَيْتُمُ الصَّلَاةِ فَأْتُوهَا عَلَيْكُمُ السَّكِينَةِ. When you come to pray, you should come with tranquility and walk with calmness. وَلَا تَأْتُوهَا وَأَنْتُمْ تَسْعَوْنَ. You should not rush, you should not haste, nor jog. فَمَا أَدْرَكْتُمْ فَصَلُّوا وَمَا فَاتَكُمْ فَأَتِمُّوا. And whatever you catch with the imam, join in. And whatever you missed, make it up or complete. The right narration and the sound narration is completed. So if you join the imam in the second rak'ah, that means you missed the first rak'ah. To you, your first rak'ah is your very first rak'ah. So you pray with the imam and he gives you a chance to recite Surah Al-Fatiha and he recites another surah after. Then in his third rak'ah, that is your second rak'ah as a follower. So you get to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, and if there is a chance, you recite a short surah or a few verses. And if you do not have a chance, you're exempt because the recitation after Al-Fatiha is a sunnah. And since you're an imam, it does not affect your prayer. Since you're a ma'mum or a follower, it does not affect your prayer, nor are you required to offer sujudu as-sahw. Then when the imam finishes, you are resuming, completing what you have to pray, not make up. Because when I say make up, that means you have to consider the number of rak'ahs which you offer afterward as a make up or a qada, which will require you to recite a surah after al-fatiha, etc. But this is not the case according to the more right view, which is the opinion of al-jumhur, in the light of the hadith which I quoted. Wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam. Another phone call. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
Sister Noura from Sudan, how are you?
How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah
Rabbil Alameen. I have one question regarding prayer, witr.
Noura, are you from the north or south of Sudan?
I'm in the north, in Khartoum, alhamdulillah.
Okay, great. Go ahead.
I usually try my best to pray tahajjud every day. I know that the best time is to wake up the last third of the night. Mm. So usually I'll wake up about 5 to pray tahajjud and so on and so forth. But there are times when I get carried away, and when I'm about to pray my witr or right in the middle of my witr, the azan sounds. Mm. Does my witr count, or, you know, should I discontinue the witr?
You started.
What should I do?
You started your witr before the adhan started, right?
Yes.
Okay, that does count as long as you started it before the adhan started.
Okay. The second question, last question: what is the right way to, as an imam, when you are leading asar or zuhur, are you supposed to read the al-fatiha out loud in the first two raka'ah?
Okay. I will have to answer this question right now because we do have a pending question from the last episode. The sister was asking about what if you are a follower or a ma'mum and you forgot to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. We know that according to Al-Jumhur, which is the most valid view and the more right, is that whether you are an imam or a follower, everybody must recite Surah Al-Fatiha on their own. Particularly in the rak'ahs which the imam is reciting silently, or in the prayer which is entirely silent, such as Dhuhr and Asr, and the remaining two rak'ahs of Isha, and the remaining one rak'ah of Maghrib. Unlike the view of Imam Abu Hanifa, who adopted the view that if the person is praying in congregation, he does not have to say nothing. He just stands still and does not even recite in himself because the Imam is reciting on his behalf. So I say, due to the sound ahadith and the continuous testimony of these ahadith, every person must recite Surah Al-Fatiha on their own. The last episode's question was, according to the opinion of Al-Jumhur, what do you do if you forget the Fatiha, if you are a follower or a ma'moom? In this case, after you finish with the Imam, you make up an entire rak'ah. Because the recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha is a rukn, is one of the pillars of a salah. Similar to if somebody forgot to make ruku'ah or forgot one of the two sajdas, and now he is involved, re-indulged into the second rak'ah and pass the same position in the second rak'ah. So in this case, the entire rak'ah which you missed, the recitation of Al-Fatiha in it, or its ruku'ah, or one of its sujood, is invalid, and you must make it up again, as it did not happen. Thank you, Sister Noura, and I hope that we answered your question with regards to the recitation of Surah Al-Fatiha if you are a follower. Okay, there was another caller, and it was cut off. So please try to call us again. Thank you so much. Sister Halima had a couple of questions before the break. The first is pertaining the adhan of Fajr. Is it one or two adhan? There are two adhans. One which was at the time of the Prophet ﷺ would be called by Abdullah ibn Maktoum in order to alert people that were approaching the time of Fajr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. You may eat and drink until it has become apparent or clear to you the white thread from the black thread. The white thread is referring to the daytime, and the black thread is referring to the night time. That is actually the dawn time, and that is the beginning of Fajr time, where you may now start praying Fajr, Sunnah obviously, then the Fajr. And it is declared by the Adhan. Now everybody has a clock and has a time. The first Adhan, as the Prophet ﷺ said, do not be undertaken by the Adhan of Ibn Maktoum. It does not and it should not stop you from eating and drinking. It is similar to what many countries nowadays, they present in their timetable during Ramadan, they say imsak time, which I repeatedly mentioned that is not the right thing to present to Muslims. When we say imsak, that means you must stop eating or drinking. Rather, it is to prepare yourself to stop eating and drinking. But you may eat and drink, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, hatta yatabayyana lakum al-khayt al-abyad min al-khayt al-aswad min al-fajr, Surah Al-Baqarah. So only the second adhan, which counts for fasting, which counts for the prayer. If somebody heard the first adhan and started praying the sunnah of Fajr, it doesn't count because that's still a part of the night. The second adhan is the actual declaration of entering the Fajr time for the prayer itself. Wallahu a'lam. Brother Ali from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Aisha, I'm sorry. Aisha? Okay, brother Khurshid from the United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah, Sheikh Salah.
How are you?
How are you? How are you, sir?
Alhamdulillah wa shukrillah.
Sheikh Salah, I am having two questions, very quick questions. I have purchased a house in India for 2.5 million rupees, which is local currency.
Okay.
Alhamdulillah. So the possession I will get after 3 years. So between for these 3 years, I have to pay zakah on that?
On what?
Or not?
Do you still possess the money?
Sorry? Yeah, I have given the total money, 2.5 million.
You've paid the full amount, right?
full amount I have paid, but pension I will get after 3 years, in 2013, inshallah, if I would be alive.
You mean you pay, but you will get the property in 2000, whatever?
13, yeah.
13. So you have not owned the property yet?
No.
Okay. What are you planning to do with the property?
No, I will definitely live in that.
Okay, so there is no zakah on it, whether you receive it now or later, as long as this is a property that you're planning and intending to build a house on it and live in it. May Allah bless you in it. Allahumma ameen. There is no zakah on it.
And second question, doctor, when we are praying Dhuhr and Asr behind the Imam, should I read Alham Sharif and any ayah or not? Or should I keep silent?
Okay, this is what I just answered in a few minutes ago. According to the opinion of the vast, vast majority of the jurists, and this is obviously the opinion of the companions, according to many sound hadith, including the hadith of Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, when he narrated that the Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَأْ بِأُمِّ الْكِتَابِ فَصَلَاتُهُ خِدَاجِ. If one does not recite the mother of the book, which is Surah Al-Fatiha, then his prayer is incomplete and is insufficient. So everybody must recite Surah Al-Fatiha in their prayer. I know that because my major was Hanafi, and I know the brothers and sisters who are coming from the Indo-Pak background mainly follow the Hanafi madhab, that it is of the view that if you are a follower, you don't have to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. But nevertheless, we have to remember that Imam Abu Hanifa, Shafi'i, wa Malik, wa Ahmad, me and you and every Muslim are the followers of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when we have a sound hadith, and this is the opinion of the companions and the vast majority of the scholars and the more right view, I do not say, but I'm Shafi'i or I'm Maliki or I do not follow that madhab, rather I follow that madhab, because all of us should follow the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is what I present to you. And I hope and I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will guide us to what's best. Brother Khushid, thank you so much. And once again, may Allah bless you in your property and in your house. It pleases my heart to know that Muslim brothers and sisters are making investment, halal investment, in buying properties and houses. And may Allah give you a better house in paradise. Allahumma ameen. Very important question, Brother Muhammad from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, who's asking about the interest money which he collected, and he knows that it's interest and he wants to discard it and get rid of it. So he says that in India they have the bad habit that the boy collects the dowry. It's the contrary to the truth that a boy or the groom must pay the dowry to the bride. Can I pay this money to him because my niece or whoever is getting married? Anyway, this is haram and this is haram. No, you can't, because now you are a beneficiary. Similarly, you cannot pay this money towards your taxes or paperwork or as a bribery. Some people are under the impression haram and haram and we're even. No, this is not the case. You cannot benefit whatsoever from this money. You can give it in a charity. You can give it away to an orphanage, to a school, to a hospital, fix roads, pave roads. Da'wah purposes, particularly in the West, not building masajid, but publishing materials, producing videos, da'wah materials and programs. Any person would like to support any Islamic channel, and they do have an interest that's accumulated in their account in Europe, in the States, in North America, or in the Gulf. You can just give this money to any of the da'wah organizations, because this is one of the causes. Number one, as I said, you do not hope to collect a reward on that. This is haram money that you're trying to get rid of. And meanwhile, the only reward you will get is by abstaining from consuming the haram. Wallahu ta'ala, a'la wa a'lam. I know that we still have a couple of pending questions from this episode. I was trying my best, but time is zipping by very, very fast. Alhamdulillah, we spend it in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah forgive us our sins and gather us all in His paradise. Brothers and sisters, until next episode, I leave you in the care of Allah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Allah is my heart's speech. mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest.